Why can't it just be two women who are wildly passionately in love with each other? Why does it have to be saucy and titillating and you know, erotic? You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Why can't it be? Why can't it be graceful and powerful and you know?
Hi, Kate Winslet. Thanks so much for taking the time to speak to actually today about the release of Ammonite, the stunning new romantic drama from Francis Lee. You know, it's a beautifully crafted look at the relationship between your character, famed 19th century paleontologist Mary Anning, and Charlotte Murchison, played by Saoirse Ronan. So I wonder if you could tell us, what was it that first attracted you to this project in particular that really struck you?
I'm always excited when something lands on my lap from a homegrown talent such as Francis Lee. And I really loved God's Own Country so much. And it's quite rare that I'm able to say, oh, that's my kind of film. You know, not every film is. And there was something about the language and the rhythm, the emotional language and the rhythm of God's Own Country, and visually how sparse it was, but how beautiful, and how the soundscape and the sort of sparse physical connection between people said so much. And so when I received Ammonite, I was just so excited. I was literally ready to say yes before I'd even turned the first page. And to discover what he had chosen to do with Mary in giving her a relationship with another woman, I first of all found really, really compelling to take a woman who was very hard done by society, living in that patriarchal world, that geological environment so dominated by men, and yet she was better than all of them. And it was taken from her just because she was a woman. And I admired his courage, I guess, in choosing not to pair her with a man, because if he had paired her with a man somehow, given that she was a working class woman who was very self-taught and loved what she did so much and was so highly skilled, you know, in a way, it almost wouldn't have felt worthy of her in a funny way, giving her that relationship with a male figure.
We know that Mary and Charlotte had this incredibly close personal relationship in real life, but, you know, because there's no, you know, historical, particular historical evidence documenting a romantic connection between the two, there have been plenty of people who've said, oh, this is rewriting history, or, you know, portraying her, we shouldn't portray her as queer because there is lack of historical evidence. What's your response to people that have said that about this particular film?
Well, there is lack of response. There is lack of historical evidence, and that is absolutely true. There is no historical evidence whatsoever to suggest that she had relationships with men. None. And she was not married. So I think it should be permissible to explore an alternative love life for that individual, to delve into what might have gone on in the inner workings of their heart. And I don't understand why that matters. I don't understand what difference it makes to who Mary was and her extraordinary achievements to pair her with a woman. And for me, I absolutely love and champion same-sex love stories and any LGBTQ stories that we can possibly get our hands on. And I hope that we're able to normalize same-sex connection on film without hesitation, secrecy, or fear by normalizing these relationships. And what I love about our film is that there's no shame element around Mary and Charlotte's relationship. Their love for one another isn't hidden or forbidden in some way. They just love each other. And if we want to bring more LGBTQ stories into the mainstream, then surely by normalizing them and removing the elements of shame, we're hopefully on the right path. And to be able to contribute in hopefully an honest, compassionate, and meaningful way, it will make a difference. And I felt really honored to hopefully contribute to the evolution and progression of how audiences and LGBTQ people and their relationships are presented on film.
Absolutely. And it's true to say, isn't it, that if the assumption was that she was heterosexual, then there would probably be absolutely no comments whatsoever.
Well, you know, look, the world has changed. And you're right. There would have been no comment. So why does it have to be sensationalized or commented on or criticized in any way? I mean, I don't even know if it has been actually criticized, because I just don't read things like that, to be honest. But but it just, what difference does it make? You know, and I wasn't raised like that. That's not how I was raised. What difference does it make? A person's a person.
Absolutely. And I mean, of course, you've notably played queer characters before, in both in your feature debut, Heavenly Creatures in 1994, and in Iris in 2001. You know, a couple of decades on from those films, do you have sort of, as an actor in the industry, have you noticed a difference in how this film with, you know, queer themes have been received or talked about both by the public or the media compared to those films you were making a couple of decades ago? That,
well, I still think there is a serious lack in LGBTQ films that make their way into our mainstream, you know, so I think we still feel so compelled to compare the few that do exist. And that's what I hope is going to change, you know, and I also hope by telling these stories that perhaps, you know, queer actors who might feel some degree of fear that they may not get roles because those roles, there aren't just enough parts for LGBTQ actors. I hope that by bringing more of these stories to the forefront, I'm a cisgendered woman, but what difference does it make, right? You know, everyone should be allowed to follow their path in life. And if we are able to bring more of these stories into the mainstream and into cinemas for audiences to enjoy, then perhaps LGBTQ actors might feel a little bit more, I don't know, included, welcomed, celebrated, yeah. You know? And that for me, that's, I don't know, that's how I just, it's really important to me. It's really important to me that, awesome. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you may have sort of touched on it there, but inevitably there'll be, you know, people that say that, you know, with a queer romantic drama such as Ammonite, perhaps two queer actors should be prioritized in those lead roles. So, you know, what's your personal feeling on that kind of ongoing sort of issue? And did you feel the weight of that wider sort of cultural conversation on your shoulders when you took on the role?
I was aware of that. Yeah, I mean, it's definitely, I would be foolish to say that I wasn't aware that people may feel that way. I can tell you that there were private things shared between myself and Francis and Saoirse, connected to our own pasts, etc., that we felt were relevant to add to these characters. And those aren't things that I'd be really sharing publicly. But it's like I said before, you know, the balance is off, right? I mean, let's be real here. There are a lot more straight, known straight actors in the mainstream than there are LGBTQ actors. And we definitely need to write that balance. But I hope that by being a part of this film and normalizing a same-sex connection in this way, that it will inspire LGBTQ performers to feel, just to feel more celebrated, and to hopefully change this, you know? It would be amazing if we can really see these big shifts and changes in cinema. And for my part, I wanted to contribute.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And, you know, it's true that, you know, the performances that both you and Saoirse put in are, you know, so just powerful, so nuanced. You know, how, you know, so much communicated through, you know, fleeting glances, you know, lingering touches, the smallest kind of body language. How did you go about sort of building that on-screen chemistry with Saoirse? You know, were you having to practice your longing stares across the rehearsal room?
It's very easy to stare longingly at Saoirse Ronan. we were very lucky, Saoirse and I, that we got on really well, you know, like we, similar sense of humor, we were able to really have a laugh. And actually, when you have to create such an intense relationship with someone in that way, it definitely helps when you really like one another, you know, because that doesn't, I'll be honest, that does not always happen. The actors can be quite strange and eccentric types, you know, and I always see it as my job never to judge and just to sort of muck in. But Saoirse and I had that same mucking in spirit. What we did do in rehearsal, though, was we really mapped out the emotional arc of Mary and Charlotte, making sure all the time not just to plan the specific moments of physical connection, because there are so few of them, and obviously we have those two quite significant intimate scenes, but so much is said about what they feel for one another in those tiny glances and in those very small touches. You know, she just leaves her hand for just a few seconds too long on Mary's shoulder. That was all, you know, those things were planned. And actually often they were even written into the script by Francis. I have done a lot of quote unquote love scenes in the past, predominantly with a male partner. And I have always felt that I've stood my ground. I've said, yes, I'm okay with that. No, I'm not okay with that. Doing Ammonite made me realize, have I really stood my ground? Because removing the heterosexual stereotypes, just like the space for equality and freedom and real longing and connection, you know, that just the lid goes off the whole thing. It was just amazing. And to have that female not just bond, but understanding, you know, women know what women want. Men don't always know. And sometimes you have to tell them. So actually it was just different, very, very, very different. And I feel, I don't know, it really taught me a lot. I feel like I'm kind of still learning a bit. Just about how objectified women can so easily be in a heterosexual love scene of a similar nature without us even realizing, you know, and so often a writer will write in the script, they'll write something like building pace, she's on top, dominating now, which is a horrible generalized description of what the woman is doing. Why can't she just know what she wants? Why does she have to be dominating? You know, why do we have to label women in that way? And that automatically feeds this idea of objectification, which we 100%, I think, all need to be aware of, you know? And actually different words, I think, are used to sometimes describe a heterosexual love scene versus a same-sex love scene, particularly same-sex love scenes with women. You know, words like saucy, titillating, you know, like these kind of like almost porn dated words will be wheeled out time after time. And I think everyone needs to take a little responsibility for being a bit more sensitive and mindful of their words. Why can't it just be two women who are wildly passionately in love with each other? Why does it have to be saucy and titillating and you know, erotic? Absolutely. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Why can't it be graceful and powerful and, you know?
Absolutely. And as a sort of a final note, you know, your career, you know, stretches back 25 years now. Do you feel like in terms of the experiences on set, is it improving when it comes to those kinds of issues for, you know, female actors? Has there been a noticeable change since the mid-90s when you were starting out in terms of how sort of you are handled and treated by people?
There has been a massive change. There's been a massive change. We now have things like intimacy coaches, which incidentally we actually didn't have on Ammonite. And it was, I think, largely because it at the time was not a legal requirement for film productions. I'm not even sure if it is now because I haven't done a love scene since then. So we have intimacy coaches. I mean, it makes a really big difference because sometimes it's not even just about the individuals, whether it's a man or a woman, feeling comfortable in the physical context of the scene, but sometimes it's actually just having an extra person to be that voice for you. And this is something that I wish I had had when I was younger, knowing how to even describe intimate, you know, moments, even using words like oral sex when you're, you know, when you're 20, 21 years old, it's still something that you're getting used to experiencing in your body, and saying those things out loud can be really quite frightening, especially when you're in an environment where it's all supposed to be okay and everyone's just fine with this. And it's the most unnatural thing in the world to pretend that you're performing intimate acts with someone who actually half the time you barely know. So it has changed a lot. And I think that the more women are able to sort of look out for one another on film sets as well, that will also really make a difference. And it doesn't mean saying, no, we're not doing this, we're not okay with that. It just means saying, you know, we definitely want to know how you're going to shoot this, and would you mind explaining, please, how you're thinking you might edit this together, and what lighting might you use? Because even the lighting sometimes can work to serve this sort of idea of objectifying a woman, you know?
Sadly, I think that is all we've got time for. But Kate Winslet, thank you so much again for taking the time to speak to us today about Ammonite.